Jay Crawford, Adam the Bull, Garrett Bush, Tyvis Powell, Jason Lloyd. Plus, ba-da-da-da-da, you're loving him, Mikey McNuggets. And so many big names, it would take me hours to say all of their names. The Ultimate Cleveland Sports Show starts now. Booyah!
Happy Friday!
Yes.
You got the Friday clothes on.
Oh,
what's
yeah.
the fit? Explain
hey,
it.
Man, only you can prevent forest fires.
Is that a preemptive? You know that
already
the chat room is going to get you. For
yeah,
it.
Everybody was looking around. It's a little something light.
Guys, is this the biggest, not including the Browns
yeah.
and not including the Guardians or Cavs in the playoffs?
Right.
Is this one of the biggest 3-day stretches starting tomorrow or
it
starting
is.
Tonight? Really, 4-day stretch?
It is.
In Cleveland modern history?
I mean, I don't know what the GOP convention brought. I know it was a lot of visitors. But this is, you bring up a good point.
Yeah.
You've got an expected 35-plus at the Guardians game on Monday.
Yep.
Wow. We did a stream show last night on Channel 3 previewing the entire eclipse.
Yep.
And a NASA executive said that he's expecting over 100,000 visitors in the 3-day stretch just
right.
at the Science Center. They have got all kinds of cool things set up there. Science
yeah.
exhibits, all kinds of realistic models of the future moon travel. They have those over here at the Space Center. They over at the Science Center, they expect a ton of visitors. So I think you're right.
And the though. Women's tournament.
And the women's tournament. Which,
is,
which
it's
they
hard to get a ticket to.
24,000 on the secondary.
Yeah, yeah,
that's
yeah.
the highest ticket I saw.
Yeah.
$24,000.
Yes.
Is it fair to say that at least at this moment in time, the women's game has eclipsed the men's game in popularity?
Yes.
I don't think there's any argument.
Can you imagine if I would have said that to you 5 years ago?
2 years ago.
Yeah, right.
I would have laughed.
Yeah, there's no doubt. I
and here it is.
There's way more interest in the women's tournament right now.
And shout out to OG Brad. I remember vividly having a conversation last year.
Yeah.
And he forecast this. Last year,
Brad Sellers says
yeah. this is going to be one of the best ones we've seen.
Yeah,
the game is picking up, and this year he was right.
I was hoping that Maryland would make a deep run into the tournament.
Yeah, that would have been cool. But
and I think they got bounced first
yeah.
or second
yeah.
round.
Yeah,
because
yeah, yeah.
of course his daughter plays for the Maryland Lady Tarps.
But there's a lot of fun energy in Cleveland.
It's
right
a good
now.
Buzz, isn't
yeah, yeah,
it?
Yeah.
I wish the weather would turn.
It's supposed to Monday
this
I
morning.
Think. Yeah, yeah. The weather's still supposed to be cold this weekend. Monday's supposed to be nice. It's supposed to be 60.
62. Showers in the morning. So
yeah.
if you wake up on eclipse day and it looks like this, don't
yeah.
be worried.
It's supposed to clear
Betsy
up, right?
Betsy and our three-team meteorologists assure me that by early a.m., like even perhaps before we wake up, that storm system will have moved out.
Nice.
And it's not going to be sunny, high blue skies.
Right.
It's going to be partly cloudy. But I'm assured from – Betsy was at the – path of totality at the 2017 eclipse in Jefferson City, Missouri.
Yeah.
She said it's similar weather day there, and it was the most amazing experience she's
yeah,
ever had.
Yeah, I can't wait.
Yeah, so we're all very much
make sure you wear your glasses, your special glasses.
Oh, I'm glad you said that.
Yeah.
Friend of show, Matt Colleague, and I gave out
this was awesome.
Over
I saw this on social
600
media.
Pair yesterday to the Urban Community School. We went there. Everybody, kids in grades K through 6, got a pair of eclipse glasses and a little goodie bag that Channel 3 and Colleague Giving passed out to the kids, and it was amazing. We went to all these classrooms, K through 6, and I was quizzing the kids on what they know about the eclipse, hoping that I go to the kindergarten class first.
Yeah.
A 5-year-old raises his hand, says, yes, I know what that is. That's when the moon goes between the orbits of the Earth and the sun and completely blocks, 5 years old. My mouth is
That's
a gate.
Impressive.
And by the time we were in the 5th grade class,
yeah.
they were telling me things about the eclipse that I had never heard.
Yeah.
I've been studying it like a madman for the last 3 months. And they were educating me on it.
That's impressive. Good for them.
Really impressive.
They have a thing called the internet now, and they are experts.
They are all over it. And you know what? That's exactly what I thought. I was looking at reports that they had done for their class experiment. They've been studying this for weeks.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at it going, if I had to do something like this, I would have had to spend 5 hours in the library
God.
Pulling all kinds of encyclopedias
oh,
and everything.
Yeah.
And they're sitting at home, Google, Eclipse, fax,
I know you guys are old enough to remember this. Like, you know, it was like one of those things. It was an investment. Like, I was going to be there, like, his foreign exchange student, right? And it was this investment. Well, my parents weren't getting anybody back in return. They were just shipping me off to the school. they didn't have nothing in return.
A one-for-none trade.
Yeah, it was a one-off. Like, but one of the big things was I got a set of encyclopedias.
Oh, yeah.
Like, when you got that, like, the entire set.
Oh, yeah. I remember when my dad bought that. Yeah.
And I wore those out.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
I used to, as a 7-8-year-old, I would just hold those in my hand and flip through the pages by the hour. I can still smell the pages.
That's something the kids don't know. They probably don't even know what the hell an encyclopedia is.
You're right. I bet they don't.
And they were just, and like, that was like the shelf of knowledge. I remember.
It really was. That was our Google.
That was it.
I would look at it for fun sometimes.
Oh, like, I always look at it for
animals and things like
just
that.
Just out of curiosity. Yeah, and you know what? Sometimes I would just randomly grab a letter.
Yeah.
Because they were alphabetized. Yeah. I would grab a letter. And I would randomly flip the pages and stop and just, what can
whatever.
I learn about Malaysia today?
I was strange. I used to put, I don't know, this is, don't judge me. I used to put a bunch of clothes, like clothes that I would throw on the floor that were clean. I would put them in a dryer with a dryer sheet. I would get them real warm. I would then go into my closet, throw all the clothes over my body and read encyclopedias. Wow. With a flashlight.
Okay, that's a weird fetish, but I'm here for it. I'm here for it. It's called, if you look this up in World Book, it's called warm clothes knowledge seeking fetish.
Yeah, that's a big one
for everybody.
I would be like, yeah, I remember, this is stupid. I remember being under there and be like, let's see. So
why did the clothes have to be warm?
I don't know, man.
Comfort.
I was secure. In that little closet.
Was it cold in there?
It was cold because it was like one of those extension things. It didn't have no heating source.
Uh-huh.
And I remember reading in this chapter, like, blew my mind. I was like, is the universe going to end in a big crunch or a big rip? And I was like, Mom, universe is over. It's expanding.
The only question is crunch or rip?
And then she's like, dude, you're doing way too much.
Yeah, you're looking too deep.
Yeah, stop.
Oh, the good old days.
Yes.
But that's a great point by Bull to start the show, because if you're in and around Cleveland, it's going to be a madhouse. We had on our stream show last night the representative from ODOT, and this is something that people don't think about, but I'm going to tell you, because he put the fear of God in me when he said this. He said, imagine you've got three Browns games all ending at the same time downtown.
Right.
That's what this could be like.
They've declared, I don't know if it's Niagara Falls, Canada.
Right.
They've already preemptively declared a state of emergency there because they're worried they're going to be overwhelmed by people that are coming.
Oh, that's another really cool place to watch it.
Yeah, of course.
So they're in the path of totality as well.
Yes, apparently
that's interesting. Yeah. Well, the ODOT guy said, look, everybody is going to, when it's over, and the actual event, the totality eclipse is only going to last 3 minutes and 17 seconds. When it's over, everybody's inclination is at the end of a fireworks show.
Starting to roll.
Let's get in the car, let's jet. And then you sit in gridlock. Well, the way he put it, like three Browns games downtown, oof, all ending at the same time.
I know.
Prepare yourself for gridlock. So what he said is make a different plan. We're going to go down, watch the eclipse. Then we're going to go somewhere for dinner.
Yeah.
Or we're going to spend time at the Science Center or whatever.
Yeah.
But if everybody that's downtown for this event leaves at once, you're not going anywhere.
No.
That reminds me of that commercial from, I think when you say you're starting to act like your parents.
Yeah, right.
And the
one where he says, we need to really start beating this traffic right now. And they're like,
Dad,
it's halftime.
Dr. Rick.
We
Dr.
mentioned
Rick.
This the other day.
We did. We talked about Dr.
LL
Rick
Cool
the other
J.
Day.
Yeah.
Those commercials are absolutely the best. They're so good. All right, busy show. Deshaun Watson makes a proclamation. We're going to talk about that. That's going to be our leadoff topic. But we're also going to talk about the Guardians because,
It's been impressive.
We sat in these chairs a week ago and said, what's your ideal record coming home?
Yeah.
And we had kind of decided that 6-4 would stir optimism. You get to 7-3 and 8-2, there's going to be even more buzz. They're already 6-2, last two games, house money.
I know. If you could just don't get swept in those two at this point. I don't want to split those next two, and I'm good. And then you – And not only are you at home, not only is everybody in a good mood, you're playing the White Sox, they stink, you have a chance to really pile up some wins early. It's
exciting. The key is, we kind of poo-pooed the 3-1 start against the A's.
Yeah.
That's a 4A minor league team.
Yeah.
But here recently, they're 3-1 against not only good teams, but teams with good pitching.
Yeah, they've just beaten three top 15 pitchers in a row.
In a row, which is, that's a nice feat. Yeah. They're wrapping the ball. Their pitching has been, Sean Bieber's Cy Young again.
So far. And Logan Allen bounced back after his first start, which wasn't great.
Good.
And Bybee yesterday bounced back after his first start, which wasn't great.
The only question marks, Eli Morgan.
Yeah, he's struggling. But he's a hot and cold guy.
I know he is, goes but through he's hot cold, and cold right now.
I would not put him in a big spot. I'll tell you who I'd give a shot in a big spot. Cade Smith.
We talked about him. Were you here when we talked about him? No, it was Monday.
Oh, yeah.
I said Cade Smith's my new favorite guardian.
Yeah, give him a shot in a big spot because he's tied for second on the team in strikeouts, or at least he was before yesterday.
Well, I think he had four strikeouts in the first five guys he faced.
He's got 9 Ks already.
His family was at that game, too, which was really cool to see. Yeah. It was really cool to see. All right, much more to get to on the program, including we're going to build the ultimate Browns quarterback from the modern-day Browns, 99 post. And we're going to take all these different attributes, and we're going to say, you know, so-and-so had the best arm. So-and-so is the best clutch player. I got to tell you, of all the assignments you've given us, this one was the most difficult.
This is hard.
Not because there were so many close, like, calls to break. There were some areas where I'm like, clutch?
Yeah, who's close?
I got nobody for you.
And we got a bunch of fan responses, too, that we will
incorporate. We did this, Jay, for the ultimate Guardians hitter.
I saw you were going to do that. What did you come up with?
It was pretty close. Jason and I had, the only difference between Jason and I was for best swing. I had Julio Franco.
Oh, wow.
And he had, I can't remember who he had.
Wow,
but
Julio, you're going
back. We had Manny in there. We had Tommy in there. Yeah. We had
Tommy's
Alomar.
Mine.
We had Roberto Alomar.
Good.
We had Albert Bell and Kenny Lofton.
Very good.
Tyvus put Franmil Reyes for his power swing.
Yeah, which was insane.
That
was insane.
There's a difference.
Has he ever watched Guardians baseball?
There's a difference between.
Not before 2017.
Best swing and prettiest swing, because Russell Branyan had the prettiest swing of
Russell
all time.
Russell had the swing.
That boy, that left.
Yeah,
that,
he did. Yeah.
He was the white Griffey.
Well, it was batting stance. That's why I picked Julio Franco for batting stance.
He knock-kneed.
Yeah, and then he had the bat all the way up here.
He was like a 48-ounce bat, something crazy like that.
You could argue he had the best and the worst batting stance, depending on
what you want. It was fun to watch.
We'll have some fun with that in a little bit, and we're going to start with Deshaun Watson after a quick word from Robinhood. Did you know that even if your 401k for retirement is your current plan, you can still have an IRA as well? Robinhood has the only IRA that gives you a 3% boost on every dollar you contribute when you subscribe to Robinhood Gold. But get this, now through April 30th, Robinhood is even boosting every single dollar you transfer in from other retirement accounts with a 3% match. That's right, no cap on the 3% match. Robinhood Gold gets you the most for your retirement thanks to their IRA with a 3% match. The offer is good through April 30th. Get started today at Robinhood.com/boost. Subscription fees apply. And now for some quick legal info. Claim as of quarter one, 2024 is validated by Radius Global Market Research. Investing does involve risk, including loss. Limitations apply to IRAs and 401ks. Robinhood Financial LLC is a registered broker-dealer. And Bull, before we start, Anthony, please pull up the Miles Straw thing I sent you.
Oh.
I want to show you something real quick. I meant to do this earlier, forgot. But there was a Miles Straw tweet that I sent Anthony, he's going to pull in real quick, that I need your live reaction to.
Mm.
Is this a recent, like,
this is,
fresh?
And I sent it to you this morning. There it is right there. Give me one sec. Bull, I need your live reaction to this Miles Straw tweet from yesterday. And Anthony's getting in tag board. Steve, as soon as it's in tag board,
the highest paid player in AAA.
And play it.
Maybe minor league history.
Miles Straw with a 146-mile-an-hour line drive of the bat for a base hit in the fifth.
It's cute.
Hey, he hit it hard.
Hey, he's out there.
Way to rip that AAA pitching.
What is he hitting? Do we know?
I can tell you in a sec when we get to the Guardians. But now let's talk a little to Deshaun Watson here, guys. Yesterday at the opening of his restaurant, which we will preview in full in the TV show coming up on WKYC at 12:30, he made a proclamation that he'll be ready for week one of the NFL season. Here's Deshaun in his own words on how his rehab going and how he is confident he'll be ready for the start of 2024? Steve, you can play.
Very, very good. You know, the process is, you know, day to day, and we just got to take it one step at a time. We can't do anything too crazy. We can't jump the gun and try to do too much. The biggest thing right now through this process is load management and just continue to, you know, find ways to just get better and just stay on that course. So, you know, I'm trusting all the doctors, the PT, Dr. Eletrosh, and his team out in L.A. with the Cleveland Browns, and we just, you know, follow their role, and, you know, we'll be ready by week one. No, most definitely. I'll be better than I was before in week one. So, you know, I'm very confident in the roles of the doctors. You know, like I said before, Dr. Eletrosh and his team, following their lead, and just all the research that I've done, and then just my work in preparation. You know, I put my whole life into this, and, you know, I want to make sure I come back even better than before.
I think it's interesting, Jay, that he mentioned Dr. Eletrosh, who's known as one of the big baseball surgeons.
He is. I was surprised to hear him say that name,
right,
too.
And so maybe this type of injury is more common in baseball, I guess. I don't know.
I remember when it first happened, we kind of researched it.
Yeah.
Nobody had
There's
it.
Not another comparison from a football player.
No, not that I've heard
so
of.
So maybe it is. I'm not familiar that it is more of a baseball injury. You can understand how it could be. But I was glad to hear him mention his name because he's widely regarded
right.
as the guy.
It used to be Dr. Andrews.
Dr. Andrews, right.
And now it's Dr. Eletrosh with all the pitching surgeries
right.
happened to him.
They got Dr. James Andrews out of here after a while.
He's got the old. I was surprised he worked out. He was out of Birmingham.
Yeah.
And I'm like, interesting that the guy would be out of Birmingham's. Like,
you wouldn't have guessed that.
You don't think that is a medical hub.
No, definitely not.
But I was glad to hear that name, too. It's funny you brought that up because that was one of the things that went off that I like. We'll talk about the declaration that you're going to be ready for week one in the first week of April. Do you guys like that? Would you rather he be a little more secretive about what's going on with this or what? Where are you?
It just seems to me like that's how confident he is, like, in it. Like, you know, when you've had surgery a lot, you know, I could only compare it to what I could compare it to. Like, you know the difference between, you know, when you have surgery on one leg or you have surgery on the other. I've torn my ACL in my left knee and the right knee. And when I had ACL surgery on the left knee, I was like, oh, I actually had the feeling of, oh, I'm better than I was before. Right. Like I was a predominantly left foot jumper off one leg. And I'm like, man, I still feel explosive off this leg. Now this right one, I felt like I was, you know, at being 25, I thought I was like 35.
Yeah.
Like it just would swell up. I couldn't get the swelling out. I was taking anti-inflammatories. They was draining it. And I'm asking him, like, what is the difference between this one and this one? He said, look, no injury is the same, right? You know, sometimes technology gets better to a point where you come back and that knee is ready to go better than it was before. So I think it's a product of Deshaun being like, man, I got taken care of. I'm throwing the ball easy. You know, even when he was there, as we was covering the event, he wasn't visibly anything with his arm. He was doing some stuff back in the kitchen, signing autographs. And it just looked like he was healthy. Like, it looked like it wasn't something wearing on him. Last year, when he talked about his shoulder and the nagging, you could kind of tell in his demeanor because sometimes he didn't even want to talk.
Sure.
And he was like, I don't want to talk to the
You can wear pain in your shoulder on your face.
Yes.
Sure.
when you hurt enough, Jay, when you know you got that ass surgery, it's just all over your face.
Food doesn't taste good anymore.
No,
nothing is funny. You're in pain.
You have to apologize to your wife all the time.
In advance.
In advance. Hey, I'm just
here. Hey, I might snap at you later today, but that's the shoulder
talking.
That's
the neck. That's the neck injury right now. Just let me be. But, no, I think you're feeling good, Bull.
You know, I like the confidence. I like that he believes in himself. I think whenever, whether it's Deshaun Watson or any other player, when they talk about coming back from an injury, you're always going to take it with a grain of salt. Mm. Not that he's lying, but of course he wants to be confident. He wants to portray that confidence. And maybe he is going to be fine. But we know that, as you said, every injury is different. You don't know what setbacks. Maybe he has no setbacks along the
right.
way. We don't know what setbacks he may or may not have along the way. So who knows? The fact that he's confident this far in advance, the fact that he's already throwing the ball, makes me believe he should be ready to go.
Right.
But here's an interesting thing. I had Charles Davis on my podcast this week. Great NFL analyst.
I love Charles Davis.
Yeah, he's fantastic. And he made a really interesting point to me about Deshaun Watson. He goes, he said, Deshaun hasn't gotten better obviously. That's obvious. But he has spent so much time in the last couple of years either not playing because of suspension or the sitting out with Houston or rehabbing from injuries. Mm-hmm. And he said he made the point, you know, sometimes we think about, oh, is a guy going to be ready to play? But you don't, in the offseason, you want your best, your players to not just be ready, but to have worked to improve their game.
Exactly. Yeah.
And so if you're spending the whole offseason just rehabbing, you can't really do the other part of improving your game. Yeah. So it's not just about Deshaun coming back. It's about, is he coming back and going to be healthy enough in, say, July that he can get better in training camp?
That's a huge point, Bull.
Like, it is a good
point. I was really interesting when Charles Davis said that.
When he said that, I remember spending two calendar years just rehabbing, right?
Yeah.
And I remember the first time I stepped back on the field and guys that were not as quick, guys that weren't as big or strong, guys that you just had a natural, you know, say a natural, you know, talent gap between, all those guys had passed you and gotten better.
Sure.
And it was the most frustrating thing in the world because I'm like, I'm still the same. These dudes, and this guy's this walk-on's guy, I'm like, you can see guys getting better and faster and stronger, and you're less effective. And then the most frustrating part was you got to spend more time in preparing your body beforehand and afterwards.
Right.
So they're going to lift weights, still getting better after practice. You're going to get stretched out and iced.
Yeah,
and they're still getting better. So it's very frustrating. That's a great point he brought up. So,
Jay, what about you?
First of all, I'm glad he's confident.
Yeah, sure.
And he's clearly confident. He's not hedging his bets.
Right.
I'll be ready to go.
Yeah.
And I love that. I think that that's great because there's something that I learned a lot about from rehabbing so many injuries. Yeah. I'm rehabbing one right now. The psychology of rehab. And I had always blown that off, especially when I was younger.
Sure.
I thought, psychology of rehab, what the hell is that? Yeah. But then I realized, particularly with three ACLs, it is a real thing. As you know, even though the doctor says green light, you are now 110% in your bad leg compared to your strong leg. Mm-hmm. And I said, oh, okay, so you're thinking this one's stronger than my previously stronger leg. So you must be great. But it never, there's always a little voice in your head saying, what if it happens again? First of all, the pain of it is excruciating. Now, his injury wasn't as excruciating as an ACL tear, but it hurts so bad. I did ACL, MCL, PCL first time. I actually went into shock. I was in shock. When I got to the emergency room, they said, yeah, you're in shock right now. Because I was like, yeah, I'm fine. It doesn't hurt.
Yeah.
But I'd already gone through that pain threshold where it was so painful, I just didn't feel anything anymore.
I was it hurt so bad. I was hyperventilating.
You go through that.
And the doctor said, just calm down. I said, but you're bewildered. You're like, but I don't know what happened. You don't want to look down. They're pushing you down. Don't look that way. But yeah, that you know it. It's the pain and it's always there. It's always, what if I take the next hit? What if I just make a cut? What happens if, because you know you're good, but that 5% is always there.
And you do let go of it, I will tell you from experience, but not until you've gone through the repetitions of game.
Yeah.
Because nothing can simulate game speed like games. That's it.
Yeah.
So he might feel fine throwing the ball right now, and I'm glad that he does. And he might feel confident that this thing is healed and you're not going to have a relapse in any way. But until he's taking consistent hits on that shoulder and bouncing up and saying, yeah, I made it through it, there's no validation that can drop that psychology from your mind. I am 5 weeks post-surgery. I was throwing objects softly on Monday or Tuesday, and I was like a kid in a candy store. And in 3 weeks, I'll get to throw a ball forcefully for the first time. And my doctor's saying, we're going to creep up to that. Mm-hmm. And when you do it, we're going to ramp up your velocity. We're going to ramp it up. And then we're going to have you throw 20 fastballs in a row. And it will be at that point where you start believing it's healed and there won't be a relapse. But no, not for me. It won't be until four starts into my regular season where I don't have pain at all before I start to say, I can now put this thought out of my mind. So I love that he's ready for week one in his mind.
Right.
I love that. I really do. My preference, though, and I'm glad you phrased the question the way you did, Mike. My preference would be that he just hold that right here. Here's the answer. everything's going great.
Yeah.
I'm according to schedule. I'm throwing the ball pain-free. I'm very excited about the start of the season. Let's see what happens.
Because we'll all assume a setback if he's not ready or it doesn't seem
That's exactly ready. Right. It's like but when your parents tell you, we're going to the zoo on Friday.
Right.
And then Friday comes around and says, no, psych, no zoo for you today.
Yeah.
Now you're upset. So hold the expectations and surprise all of us in a good way.
You know, you brought up psychology. It's something that in sports when we were all coming up, nobody ever talked about psychology.
No.
Nobody ever talked about mental health, how you're feeling, how you do. When you get hit in the face, especially with a pitch in baseball,
right?
That's a mental hurdle to get over.
Some guys never do.
You get the yips. Remember Steve Sachs or Mackie Sasser?
Couldn't throw the ball back to home plate.
What's that, Mike?
Chuck Knobloch.
Chuck Knobloch. You get the yips. It's a mental hurdle to get. Even there's a pitcher, Daniel Bard, who was with the Red Sox, got the yips, was out of baseball for 7 years. He's been with the Rockies.
Didn't he come back?
He did. He's been with the Rockies. He's on the injured list right now. Whether it's any of those things or it's just dealing with a traditional injury or just dealing with everything that Deshaun Watson's had to deal with in the last couple of years.
Sure.
It's the biggest thing I think we all, certainly I, disregarded when the Browns traded for him is the mental hurdles he's got to get over. Obviously, now he's got physical hurdles that he has to overcome. But the mental hurdles are part of this. As human beings, we all have mental hurdles. And there's no doubt, I mean, it seems very obvious that there are mental hurdles that he has to still get over.
Right.
From everything he's been through the last 3 years.
And even when you throw that, you know, my dad used to always tell me, you know, I played 3 sports. And sometimes, you know, I would just be like, "Nah, I'm just tired of going to practice. Like, can I just play the games?"
Oh, yeah.
And he's like, "Listen, the second you stop playing year-round, if you stop playing baseball for a year, if you stop playing basketball for a year, especially those two, you can play football." He said, "But even when you got football, when you take a year off, when you get back, it's going to be different. Again, speed of the game, you got to adjust to it, and people have gotten better."
Well, and that's to your point that you made earlier. It's not just like you're standing still, but everyone keeps moving. When you stop using a skill set, it regresses.
Yeah, that's right.
So you're not, and that's why I love the point that you guys made about he's got work to do just to get back to baseline.
Yeah.
Then we can start thinking about improving upon his game and the work that that takes. So when you're injured, what's the most frustrating thing about it is, yes, everybody moves forward. Everybody's continuing to hone their skill set. I can already feel my right arm muscles atrophy because for 4 weeks I wasn't allowed to do the normal exercises that I normally do. And now this week I'm allowed cleared to start doing them again. And I've noticed I'm not as strong. All of the numbers that I was doing, sets, reps, and weight, I can't reach right now because I didn't stand still. I went this way.
Right.
And that's the psychology of injury and rehabbing. Yeah,
I wonder if it's really pointless at this point, but I wonder if Deshaun Watson had to do it all over again the year that he sat out with Houston. Now, if he wanted to play that year, would they have let him because the whole thing was hanging over?
Right.
I guess you never know. But I wonder if he had to do it over again if he would have played that year for Houston.
That's a good question.
Because he probably would have been better off if he had.
But if you think about it, the trajectory of his entire career is likely different.
Yes.
He's not in Cleveland. Who knows what happens? If he plays very, very well and there becomes a bidding war, he likely goes somewhere else.
Right. Maybe.
So, I mean, who knows? But I would love to give him truth serum and have him give the honest answer to that question because that is a really interesting question.
And we've seen, like, let alone we talk about the, you know, you playing the quarterback position, there's other things that go into it. Like, Myles Garrett can force himself to, like, play after a car accident and still be slightly effective on pass rushes because he has his legs. He has other things that he can use to perfect the game. Deshaun Watson has to not only have the mental aspect, he has to have the emotional aspect together. He has to be able to throw the ball with power. We don't know whether or not that affects his arm strength.
Well, to that point, his injury is his motor. If he was a race car, he's got a blown engine right now.
Yeah.
Because that's his most important tool, is his throwing shoulder.
Right.
And if that's damaged, that's like a car blowing a motor.
And
it's not like a flat tire.
And you got to deal with the accuracy standpoint. Like, does it affect your accuracy?
Right.
Can he throw the ball where he wants to throw the ball? How pinpoint is he? Does he have an arm to fit it in there? See, that's difficult. If you come back and you say, you know, think about it. They got camp arm, right? It's the thing called camp arm.
Yeah, there
camp
is.
Fatigue. So before he's gone through it and said, oh, it's just a camp fatigue. But what happens if it's, you get back and say, well, my arm, it gets fatigued sometimes now. Like, it didn't do that before.
Sure.
And a lot of people have to change their game based upon injuries. And it's tough for a quarterback to do that.
And Jay, you'll appreciate this because when you get, as you get older, not that he's old, but you, and let's say he can't throw it quite as hard as he used to. Well, he's got to find a way to adjust his game physically and mentally to say, hey, I can't do all the things I used to be able to do. I got to find a new way to win. Or think about C.C. Sabathia, right?
Sure. Yep.
C.C. was a great pitcher, and then he started going downhill with the Yankees. And then at the end of his career, he adjusted the way
he
was pitching.
Reinvented himself.
And the last couple of years with the Yankees, he got back to – he wasn't the guy he was in Cleveland early with the Yankees, but he was a good pitcher again after it looked like he was done.
Do you remember Frank Tanana?
Yeah, of course.
He was a fireballer in the 70s with the California Angels at the time.
Yeah.
Nolan Ryan was his teammate.
Yeah.
He threw like Ryan in the high 90s. He was a powerful, overpowering pitcher.
Yeah.
He lost velocity due to injury,
yeah.
and he had to completely reinvent himself and did so with a curveball that allowed him to extend his career for years and be a winner.
That's right. A lot
and
of
so
guys can't do
thing.
That.
No, a lot of guys can't.
Right.
So that's an interesting point about Deshaun because if he loses some velocity.
Yeah, we don't know. I'm just saying.
We don't know that.
Right.
But if he does, can he reinvent himself? And can he – there's a disconnect sometimes between this muscle and this muscle.
Oh, sure, yeah.
When you're used to, for your entire life, fitting a ball in a window and you know the depth of perception and the angle and everything else, your mind tells you, oh, yeah, I got that throw. I've made that throw my whole life.
Right.
But if the muscle doesn't cooperate,
that's
ball
right.
is picked or it's incomplete or whatever. So it'd be interesting to see what adjustments he has to make. Can he make them?
Yeah.
But I'm confident he can right now.
So we know Deshaun is the Browns quarterback of the future, but we're going to build the ultimate Browns quarterback here after a quick word from eBay Motors. Passion, drive, and patience, that's the winning formula for championships. It's also what keeps your ride or die alive. eBay Motors has everything you need to maintain your vehicle and level it up to peak performance. Superchargers, roof racks, exhaust kits, LED headlights, and more. Whether you're into speed, power, style, eBay Motors has you covered. With over 122 million parts for your number one ride or die, you'll always find exactly what you're looking for. And with eBay's guaranteed fit, your part is guaranteed to fit your ride every time or your money back. Because with eBay Motors, you're burning rubber, not cash. With all the parts you need at the prices you want, it's easy to make your car the MVP and bring home some huge wins. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions do apply. eBay Guaranteed Fit is only available to U.S. customers. Jay, you said it off the top. This was the hardest assignment I'd ever given you guys.
It was for me.
So let's do it.
It
was
challenging.
We're going to build the ultimate modern-day Browns quarterback. You can only use a player once, so one player per attribute. We have 7 attributes, and those attributes are, Steve, take tag board,
and
body.
Remember, the Browns don't have 7 good quarterbacks since 99.
No.
Weight combination, arm strength, accuracy, speed, pocket awareness, leadership, and the clutch factor.
Now,
and as a group, we're going to come together and vote on
we'll
this.
We'll pick one and decide which.
Yeah.
Okay, so
we'll start at the top. We're going to make our way top to bottom.
You can only pick one quarterback once.
Yes.
You're like, for me, for body and arm strength, I struggled between Tim Couch for both of those.
See, for arm strength, I went with Joe Flacco.
Oh, wow. You know, I really didn't even.
Even though it wasn't a lot of starts.
And but, this, so, no, but, real quick, Bull, just the one clarifying thing.
Yeah.
Like, for Flacco, you get Flacco last year. You don't get Flacco in 2012 when he was playing for Baltimore.
Right. It's only their time in the Browns.
It's tenure. So, RG3.
I don't think he lost much on arm strength.
Hey, no.
Between Baltimore and now.
For body, I ain't going to lie, I had DeShone Kizer. 6'4", 240.
See, I had for body Derek Anderson.
Yeah, he was big, really big.
Yeah.
I just thought, man, Tim Couch was.
I had Tim Couch for something else. So
yeah, you want to save Tim Couch for something else?
Well, I don't know what else. I'm curious now to see where you have
them. We're just going. Don't give away what you have. Them
yeah.
Okay.
We gotta.
Yeah. It's interesting because we named three different guys for body. And you know what? I'm fine with any of the three.
I mean, as long as I like a bigger quarterback.
Yeah.
I like six.
Well, anything all these guys
over, over 6'3".
Couch.
Couch was 6'3".
Kizer.
Kizer was 6'3".
And Anderson. For sure. Anderson was 6'6", wasn't he?
Yeah. Yes, he was.
I'd be fine with Anderson.
I would like to keep Anderson in
for
the
somewhere
mix,
else.
For somewhere
yes.
else. I would, because like we ain't got much to pull from.
Okay, so all you right. got Kizer or Couch? Who do you like, Bull?
I say go Kizer only because for me I got Couch something else. So
okay, so let's throw Kizer in as for the
so
in terms
Sean
of the
Kizer
perfect quarterback body.
Makes yeah. our
There's nothing else good about him
at all.
No, but he passed the look test.
Yeah, he did.
He definitely.
For the record, I think that's the right answer because he doesn't fit anywhere else.
No,
if you're going to use him.
But there's 25
well
other quarterbacks that don't
that's
fit anywhere
true.
Else
yes.
either.
Yeah.
All right, next we're going to arm strength.
Yeah, that's
Modern
where I got
Dave Browns
Flacco,
quarterback.
Yeah.
Whose arm strength would you put in?
I have
this
no
calculus?
Problem with Flacco.
Flacco.
I hadn't considered
he's
him
got a gun.
Because
yeah,
he was here
now.
For just a minute. I know, but holy
even
cow!
Yeah. Derek Anderson had a pretty good arm too. But for like now. Yeah, Flacco, he throws the ball through a
Flaccavelli it is.
Yeah,
it is.
There he goes.
So body, Deshaun Kizer.
Yeah.
Arm strength, Joe Flacco.
Sounds good.
Accuracy.
This one was tough for me. I'm not going to lie.
It's real tough because Deshaun Watson in Houston would have been the answer. But
sure.
And he's been, you know, his accuracy hasn't been terrible
he's
62%,
I think, as a Brown.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Man.
Now, let me throw this into the mix.
Yeah.
But you're saying just for your time for the Browns, because Baker Mayfield won the accuracy competition this past at the Pro Bowl.
Right, but as a Brown, his accuracy wasn't
accuracy
very good.
Accuracy was way below. I thought below where it should have been.
Yeah,
it's in the 50s, I think.
Jeez, who's
this one's tough? I'm not gonna lie.
I really didn't have a good answer to this one.
I don't know what was Hoyer's completion percentage when he was a Brown.
Give me one sec.
I don't remember him being inaccurate.
No, I don't.
Boy, we had some guys that struggled to complete 50% of their passes.
Yeah.
Holy cow.
Brian Hoyer, as a Brown, had a 56% completion percentage.
Yeah, that's going to be too low. That's not it.
Can we go older? What about
Colt McCoy? Can I throw Colt McCoy out there?
Where was Colt in his completion percentage?
Not good, you know?
He was here for just a minute,
Colt
too.
McCoy in Cleveland.
See, I can't. I
had
got,
a 58%.
Yeah, I need my guy in the 60s.
I can't burn.
What was Baker during his Browns years?
As a member of the Cleveland Browns, Baker's career completion percentage 61.6.
Oh, okay.
You know who I think? That, I was think. You know who I think should be it?
Who?
So crazy. Jacoby Brissett, maybe. I think Jacoby. What's his completion percentage with the Browns?
He completed 64% of his passes in 16 games with the Browns.
I mean, that might be the best they've had.
Could you imagine? Could you imagine if that's the best they've
is
had?
Is that the best they've had since 99? I think it is.
I don't know how to sort
it. I can't burn Brian Cypher Kozar yet. I can't do it.
Well, it's only since 99.
No, it's 99.
Oh, no, it's only since 99.
Oh, we're really screwed in. We're done.
That's why I said this was such a hard exercise.
I guess we got Brissett.
Tyvus says Jeff Garcia.
What was his completion percentage in Cleveland,
You know what? Jeff
though?
Garcia was very accurate.
In Cleveland, his one season, he had a 57.1% completion percentage.
Yeah, not it. But I remember
this is crazy.
But, God, is it Brissett?
I mean, I don't think Baker – did Baker – what's
Baker? Well, Baker was 61.
Baker was 61. Brissett was higher than Baker.
What about Kelly Holcomb?
How many games did Kelly Holcomb even
Kelly
play?
Holcomb.
Not many.
63.7. He did play more games than Brissett.
Okay.
I might have to go with Kelly,
Maybe
Holcomb.
It's Kelly Holcomb.
All right, you talk me into Kelly Holcomb.
All right, you know what? If we miss someone, our viewers will let us know.
They'll let us know, yeah.
Because we don't have the list in front of us.
Yeah,
I'm trying to go off my mind. So let's throw him in there because
right,
he's
Kelly.
Not going right. to be in there for anywhere else.
Kelly Holcomb.
Okay,
so body Deshaun Kizer, arm strength Joe Flacco, accuracy Kelly Holcomb.
By the way, this
Next
is
up.
Pathetic.
All right, pitiful.
This is pathetic.
I mean, beyond pitiful.
Next up, speed. Who cakes the speed
I think
category?
Deshaun. Is it Deshaun Watson?
See, the first guy I thought of was RG3.
It was RG3.
But he was here for a second. Was he still fast at that point? I don't know.
No, it was post knee surgery, so no.
You don't think RG3 could
Well, RG3 said just a couple of years ago he still runs a 4.3 40. I doubt that.
And you don't think he could beat Deshaun?
He probably.
I don't know.
He probably could.
RG3
could. He probably could.
Deshaun Watson's speed is like a 79.
Okay, let's go with – I think RG3 is probably technically the fastest that they've had.
Seneca Wallace?
You know who I put on here? And I don't know if – I put
Wallace
Josh Cribbs on here because although he was never listed exclusively as a quarterback, he played a lot of snaps at quarterback.
He did, technically.
And he would be the fastest.
I mean, I just feel like on this list –
But I think RG3 is probably our guy.
Let's go RG3.
Could you say Terrell Pryor?
Terrell Pryor
Did he actually play
too.
Quarterback for the Browns?
Yes, he did. He was just like Sean
– Yeah.
He,
Do you want to run through, Jay, real quick, do you want to run through every quarterback that played a snap for the Browns since 99, just so you have, in case 40. You're missing any? I'll do it quickly.
Yeah, go ahead.
Tim Couch, Ty Detmer, Doug Peterson, Spurgeon Winn, Kelly Holcomb, Jeff Garcia, Luke McCown, Trent Dilfer, Charlie Fry, Derek Anderson, Brady Quinn, Ken Dorsey, Brad Gronkowski, Colt McCoy, Jake Delhomme, Seneca Wallace, Brandon Whedon, Thad Lewis, Jason Campbell, Brian Hoyer, Brandon Whedon, Johnny Manziel, who maybe for speed.
RG3,
Cody Kessler, Deshaun Kaiser, Kevin Hogan, Tyrod Taylor, Baker Mayfield, Case Keenum, Nick Mullins, Jacoby Brissett, Deshaun Watson, Joe Flacco, DTR, PJ Walker, or Jeff Driscoll.
Hey, that Tyrod Taylor.
It could be Tyrod. Could be RG.
I still think RG's
right. All right, let's go with RG3. Let's stick with RG.
I mean,
RG3
let's not forget, RG3 was a world-class track athlete.
Yeah,
he's faster.
So I think we got to go
with
that.
He's faster.
All right, next up, pocket awareness.
N/A.
Pocket awareness?
We
don't even know how to say that.
I mean, this.
I can't remember a guy that I watched in a Browns uniform say, wow, now that guy's pocket aware.
Josh McCown? I don't know why his name comes into my head.
I don't know. You really could. You know what we should do is make a wheel with all 40 quarterbacks' names on it and just spin it and see where it lands. And that's
Case Keenum?
Brian Hoyer? You know what?
Brian Hoyer?
It would be
Deshaun?
Who was known for taking the fewest sacks?
Yeah. What are the other categories, real quick, Mike?
After this, you have leadership and clutch factor.
Clutch factor. I'm a hard pass. I really am, man. I got nothing. Now, I will say this, guys. Because we're looking at a list that's so crazy, that none of these guys, with the exception of Flacco, had any sustained success.
No.
I do think that. I feel like there's got to be a slot, maybe leadership for Baker. Because now remember, even though it got sideways and squirrely at the end, when he came out in that Jets game,
everybody proclaimed, we got him.
We found him. Here he is. And most of the guys that he's played with say that he is a leader.
Baker is a weird, like, there was things about him that were a good leader.
I know.
But occasionally, like that, when he talked about Duke Johnson or
that was
about
horrible.
Miles Garrett.
Do we give him a pass because that was early in his career?
Yeah, I guess. I mean, we should have, to be fair. Baker has been the best quarterback they've had since 99. I mean, he has.
So
he's got to be on there
him
somewhere.
You're not going to put him in clutch.
No, I can't put him in clutch.
I would have to put him in leadership because to this day, people still like him.
Let's put him in leadership. I mean, there's no clear, better answer for leadership.
Who you got?
We'll go for Baker for leadership.
Okay, you know? So we have pocket awareness and clutch left.
Okay, so
just to recap what we have so far: Deshaun Kaiser body, Joe Flacco arm strength, Kelly Holcomb accuracy, RG3 speed, and Baker Mayfield for leadership.
Could you imagine if the 49ers did this? The names that they would have up there.
I know.
We would just look at it and say, wow, yeah, we really stink. So we've got clutch.
For whatever reason, I want to put Tim Couch as clutch.
I want to put him as
clutch. He did have the Hail Mary.
The Hail Mary. I just feel like he was just screwed by the talent around him.
Boy, he was.
And if he had played with better talent, I feel like he would have been clutch in big spots.
Now, he also had pocket awareness, and by that, here's what I mean.
Pocket
sucks.
Yeah, right.
And he knew it.
Yeah.
He avoided many more sacks than he actually had. Can you imagine what he would have had?
There was a time when I just felt like he was a tackling dummy.
Like, every time he would drop, I would get excited when they get the ball off.
Right,
I'm like,
it was a success.
Balls out, at least
he got the ball away.
Yeah, balls out.
So let's. I'm fine with Tim at clutch. Because I tell you that Hail Mary.
Yeah.
Was something to see.
So Deshaun Watson's not going to be on the list then.
I mean, I think you can make a case.
Well, maybe pocket awareness.
Okay,
I like his pocket awareness actually.
Yeah.
So let's give him that.
We'll give him. Pocket.
We have our prototypical quarterback.
We saw his pocket awareness against Baltimore. He was moving around.
Yes, he does.
I will give him that
pocket awareness.
There it is.
And I think I think that's where he belongs.
There you go.
Okay, so before we get to, I'll go final list. I have a question, then we'll show you the fan answers.
Okay.
Our final ultimate Browns quarterback, Steve. Don't take it. Anthony, export it. We have Deshaun Kaiser. With the body. Joe Flacco for the arm strength. Kelly Holcomb for accuracy. Speed for RG3. Deshaun Watson for pocket awareness. Baker Mayfield as leadership. And Tim Couch as clutch. If that team was a if that quarterback was a real player in today's NFL, where does that quarterback rank among modern day NFL quarterbacks?
Like top
22?
I actually like this quarterback. He's big, he's strong, he's very fast. He's not that accurate, but you know, he has pocket awareness. But fourth quarter comes, I don't know if he's leading you back from the drive. So he's
guys, our clutch quarterback is Tim Couch.
Yeah.
Now I love Tim.
Yeah, love him.
You know, but, member of the show.
Yeah.
But
yeah, no.
When you think of the clutch quarterbacks that are even now, even though some really clutch quarterbacks have left the game recently, but even now there are some guys in the league that are clutch.
Even the Chiefs. The Chiefs could take half of Steve DeBerg's. Joe Montana, Patrick Mahomes, and Alex Smith and just wash us.
Honestly, guys, Joe Flacco for arm strength is the only pick I felt good about.
I'm in agreement with that.
Everything else, I'm like, well, I got to pick somebody.
No, you're right. Yeah. It was by default.
And so, no, I'm with you. I think they'd be 20-something.
Yeah, I think they would not be in the upper half for sure.
And if you did it all time, we're in trouble.
Oh, all time? You were to compare, if every franchise was to go through this exercise, we'd be 32nd. Slam dunk, 32nd.
Let's see. Who else could be in competition for the bottom? Jets?
Now, here's the thing.
How?
Did the Jets get to count just since 99 too?
No. If it's
or
all,
their whole history?
If it's all time.
Because if we start throwing Bernie Kosar, Brian Sipe, Otto Graham in there, then the conversation changes.
Yeah, exactly.
So I think for this conversation, it should be 99
It'd
close.
Have to be 99.
Yeah, who the hell are the Jets
99 through now, yeah, I mean, the Browns would be last. I mean, the Jets would be
Jets would have Pennington.
But think of every other team.
And they would have Aaron Rodgers.
The Saints have had Drew Brees. The Patriots,
the
obviously, that's a
slam dunk. The Bears situation has been pretty terrible.
Bears have not had good quarterbacks.
That's true.
You're right. The Bears.
Jay Cutler.
Even when they won their Super Bowl in 85, Jim McMahon was a middling quarterback.
Yeah.
Right.
They
that was
didn't
such
win
a
because
different
of
era.
Jim
no,
McMahon.
No, no. He was
they
long
won
for the
in
ride.
Spite of Jim McMahon.
Yeah.
So I did a real quick.
But Jay Cutler, at his best, even though he's a flawed player, was better than Baker, who's our best since 99.
You're right. No, he was.
Yeah.
I did a flash poll in the YouTube chat. Where does this ultimate Browns quarterback rank in today's NFL?
First.
37% said somewhere in the top 20. So.
I can look. That's fine.
That's
well,
reasonable.
That's a weird poll to put somewhere in the top
20. Yeah, that's a big. To, you know. So what were your other choices?
Well, the biggest answer is between 10 and 20.
Okay,
between
so you gave.
10 and 20.
Top 10.
I did top
11
five,
to 20.
Top 5.
21
top
to 32.
Top 10, top 20, or below 20.
Okay. So. What were the other numbers? How did it shake out?
13% top 5.
Oh, come on.
30% top 10.
Top 5? So 43% say top 10.
I
come
guess,
on.
Yeah. All right, well, let's run through the fan answers. And let's get these fan responses here.
That's so disgusting.
We put this on Twitter. Shout out to everyone who answered. We got, I think, 5 or 6 in here. So, Ant, take this first one. First one comes from our guy, Evan E. Light. Body, Brandon Whedon. Arm strength, DTR. Accuracy, Jarvis Landry. Speed, RG3.
Jarvis.
Pocket awareness.
That's funny.
That is
Couch,
funny.
He's about to get sacked. Leadership, Baker, and clutch, Phillip Walker.
Phillip Walker. Shout out to Tyvus on that one.
All he does is win, no matter what.
That tweet is classic.
That is good.
He stuck 3 inside jokes in there.
Yeah.
Next one comes from our guy, Tom Haynes. Body, Deshaun Kaiser. Arm strength, Derek Anderson. Accuracy, Mayfield. Speed, Watson. Pocket awareness, McCown. Leadership, Brissett.
That's a good
and
one.
And clutch, Tim.
I like
the
this quarterback.
Brissett has leadership in his right.
This quarterback is better than ours.
That's a pretty good list.
That's a pretty good list.
Tom beat us?
I think he
may
have.
Yeah, he does.
Good one.
He does.
He may have Tom.
Yeah. And Josh McCown never really got sacks like that.
Next one, Ant. Other J at SKPMD says body Tim Couch, arm strength Kaiser, accuracy Mayfield, Kaiser. Speed Garcia. He says RG3 doesn't count, but we'll give him either one pick of choice.
You know, I know he was slower, but he said, I think as recently as a year or two ago,
he still says he's
that he
fast.
Can run a 4.3.
He's still fast.
Pocket awareness was Watson, so same as us. Leadership, Brissett. I think leadership with Brissett was the right answer.
I think it was too. Kudos to our.
I'm not sure if accurate. So we switched Mayfield and Brissett.
We did.
So
yeah.
A lot of the ones we've seen switch, and he had Flacco in the clutch spot. There.
And Tim Couch is Jack now.
Yes.
Which is why I wanted to throw him in there.
He was big, but not
yeah,
big.
Yeah, he's Jack now. His he's body now is like a linebacker. Yeah. He would not be a prototypical quarterback body. I thought Brady Quinn, same thing. he got messed up in supplements and decided he wanted to look like a cover model for, In Muscle magazine.
He was just always lathered up with oil or some baby oil. I'm like, bro, you're a quarterback.
You know what? It's funny. Whenever you see, I'll throw Aaron Rodgers out there. Aaron Rodgers shirtless.
Bad body.
Like, bro, this is what Aaron Rodgers looks like.
Same thing Brady, same thing Joe Burrow.
Tom Brady famously at the combine in his picture standing there with no shirt on. You're like, this guy's not going to get
Burrow
at all.
Doesn't look great with his shirt off.
No.
Mahomes doesn't look great with his shirt off.
No, and that that is fascinating because it is, I think, and I think you guys would agree with this, the most important and the most difficult to play position in all of sports.
Oh, sure.
And we talk about fitness and health and all of this. And if you put a lineup of Aaron Rodgers, Tom Brady, Joe Burrow, and Patrick Mahomes, you're talking about four greats. And you take their shirts off, you're gonna be like, these guys are ball boys, right?
Even
they're not quarterbacks.
Even the old Marino, Montana.
Yeah.
None of those guys were jacked back in the day.
Nobody.
No. Just regular.
And then you take guys that have had that chiseled body that you would think, now that's a prototypical football player's body. Yeah. They can't throw accurately. No. They're too muscle bound in their shoulder.
They be getting tackled and sacked all the time. You can't run nobody over.
Yeah. And we got two more fan submissions I want to get to. Nathan has Tyrod Taylor as the body. Derek Anderson,
Tyrod
arm strength,
Taylor.
Accuracy, Baker. RG3 for speed, pocket awareness was Deshaun. Leadership, Flacco, and Tim Couch was his.
I don't understand the Taylor for the body, though.
I don't either.
He's short.
Yeah, he's undersized for me.
And last one here comes from. Whenever Ant switches it, I'll tell you who the last one's from.
Okay.
It has not
Could
switched.
We add,
Mike, this was a good exercise. Good job out of you.
You know, we need add another category, drug buyer. That could be Johnny Manziel.
Oh, here's the last one. It took a while.
Partier.
Last one comes from Austin. He had Kaiser for the body, arm strength, Baker, accuracy, Cody
Baker.
Kessler, speed, RG3, awareness, Flacco, leadership, Jameis Winston, which kind of doesn't count yet.
He hasn't played yet.
Clutch to Deshaun Watson. So I appreciate everyone for having some fun with that.
That was good.
Good exercise. And I like building these things as a group here. So we're going to keep doing some.
That's a good.
Some more as we move forward. Let's talk Guardians in one sec, Jay, after a word from Robinhood. Did you know that even if you have a 401k for retirement, you can still have an IRA? Robinhood has the only IRA that gives you a 3% boost on every dollar you contribute when you subscribe to Robinhood Gold. But get this, now through April 30th, Robinhood is even boosting every single dollar you transfer in from other retirement accounts with a 3% match. That's right, no cap on the 3% match. Robinhood Gold gets you the most for your retirement thanks to their IRA with a 3% match. The offer is good through April 30th. Get started today at Robinhood.com/boost. Subscription fees apply. And now for some quick legal info. Claim as of quarter one, 2024 is validated by Radius Global Market Research. Investing involves risk, including losses. Limitations apply to IRAs and 401ks. Robinhood Financial LLC is a registered broker-dealer. We have Matt Miller from ESPN, their draft expert, coming on in about 10 minutes. We'll talk more Guardians in the WKYC show coming up at 12:30. But, Jay, how about these damn Guardians, man? What a fun squad so far.
We talked last week on Friday, what would your young, we talked about what do you want them to come home at for added buzz. And we said, I said, 7-3 would definitely add buzz. 8-2, it's gonna feel really special.
Yeah.
They're 6-2. Mm-hmm. And like you said, house money with these next, just split them and you come home 7-3. Now, we definitely diminished the three wins against the A's. However, these last three wins between two against Seattle and the Twins yesterday. Wow. Bull.
Yeah.
I remember when I was doing my hit from Goodyear.
Yeah.
And I heard from some people that said, you're overly optimistic, you're hyping them up too much, and maybe I was.
Yeah.
But I just felt like, and it's super strange, I felt like, and you're going to laugh at this, the mood. I always want to take that into account. And that's only lasts for the first week of the season. Mm-hmm. And then what you do, you either build on that or detract from that.
Yeah.
But it was so weird. The mood was completely different than it was the year before when I was out there, and they were coming off a huge season the year before.
Yeah.
And I credit that to Austin Hedges. It was just the temperature in the entire room was different.
Well, he's a popular player, obviously.
They love him,
Bull. There's no doubt about it. And I think, listen – with baseball, you always have to be cautious of
Long season.
It is a long season, and I'm not changing my whole opinion on the Guardians based on eight games. It is a very promising start, though. And what I like to see is, and this is something they talked about in spring training, and so far they're doing it. They're being very much more aggressive at the plate than they've been in past years. Like, if you look at Stephen Kwan, he's got one walk and six strikeouts.
That's not like him.
That's not typical, but you know what? He's hitting the ball well. And, you know, it'll work itself out. He won't strike out a ton. But it's okay if he strikes out a little more.
And that's what I like.
He's going to be more aggressive at the plate.
He actually practiced this offseason.
Yeah.
Missing pitches.
Interesting.
He spent time
yeah.
facing 100 miles an hour on the machine and missing on purpose. So he could realize it's okay. It's
right.
okay. And I think what he's done is he's let go of that stigma of the walk of shame back to the dugout after a strikeout.
Yes.
It's okay.
Yeah.
You're going to get another chance in 30 or 40 minutes. And I like that. He's not afraid to strike out anymore, and the rest of the team isn't either, and our numbers offensively, I think we lead the American League in runs scored.
If you look at runs per game, and going into yesterday, they were, I think, tied for fourth in all of baseball.
Impressive.
You know, which is over six runs a game. And what was the final yesterday? Five?
4-2.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, listen, the offense is off to a great start. You're getting it mostly across the lineup. I mean, you know, there's nobody that's off to a terrible – obviously, Hedges is not hitting, but
sure.
almost everybody else is hitting pretty well.
Is there anything that worries you? Because I have one worry.
About the whole team?
Yeah, about their start.
My biggest concern is Tristan McKenzie.
Mine too.
I mean, it's 100%.
His velocity wasn't there.
Way down. He didn't look right.
And he got pounded pretty good.
Yeah.
You know what's an interesting stat? There are two losses, and both of them, they walked in the winning run. In both of those losses.
One of them was Morgan on four pitches.
Yeah. And the other one was it Scott? I
can't remember.
Barlow? I think Barlow might have walked
in
the winning run.
Yeah.
Tristan McKenzie, I always think, you talk about going back to surgeries, I always think that I err on the side of getting it done. I know people say, well, let's just rehab and strengthen the muscles around. I may sound dumb, but I don't know ligaments that healed on their own too well.
Like, no.
And we were talking about the mental stuff, though, Jay, and maybe there's part of him that didn't cut loose because he's
maybe.
A little worried. That's the hope. I know it's not likely, but.
It's I had the exact same thing. I opted because Tristan opted, hey, I can do this. I thought, well, let's give it a shot. So there's a procedure that they do.
Mm-hmm.
It's just not Tommy John. It's not the total replacement of the UCL. He's not the same.
No.
He's not the same.
Yeah,
and it can't be a time issue because he's had plenty of time.
You've been in.
And I'll tell you, if he doesn't regain it and he ends up tearing it, it's going to be a very, very costly miscalculation.
So he'll miss the next 2 years, pretty
and
much.
And he hasn't gotten paid yet.
No.
Now, if you remember, there were whispers the day before he got hurt. There were whispers that it just lacks the signature.
Yeah.
The two sides had come to an agreement on a signature, on a deal.
And that's
the rumor. Whether or not that's true or not, neither side ever reported that. But there were folks that cover the team telling me he's next. His extension is ready to go. Then he gets hurt. Then he decides, no, I'm not going to have the surgery. I hope for him that this wasn't a grave miscalculation and he doesn't end up needing it anyhow. Because like you said, now you got two seasons lost. Will he ever be able to prove that he's worth that big money?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I still remain concerned that they don't have enough power. Because when you play, when you get to the playoffs, you got to hit some home runs.
Yeah.
Now, again, I don't need them to be first in home runs, but I need them to be at least in the middle of the pack. You can't be last.
No.
And so they're still not hitting a lot of home runs, but they're getting a lot of doubles.
A lot of extra base hits.
Yeah, I like what I've seen from Tyler Freeman so far. I like what I've seen from Brian Rocchio so far. You know, I would assume that I just forgot his name. The first baseman is coming up. His
name's
Manzardo.
Manzardo. Name just went out of my head. I know he hit a home run yesterday. I assume he'll be up soon. But they are going to need one way or another to hit for more power. So the power still, it's better. I guess their percentage-wise is a little better than last year.
I like their aggressiveness on the bases.
Love it. Love it.
They're running like crazy.
Well, I mean, outside of Hedges and the Nailers, they all run.
Everybody's run.
Yeah.
Josh got caught stealing in an inexplicable attempt.
Right.
Right after he got hit on the wrist.
Yeah.
Why he would, you know, risk stealing a bag and sliding in head first.
Yeah.
Didn't make much sense.
And Barlow, nice job yesterday because he got off to a bad start with the Guardians, and then he gave up, his double, to, I think, to his first batter,
and then
strikeout.
Yeah, that's what he used to look like when he was in Kansas City in his heyday.
When you see him from the distance, you think Clevinger, right? I mean, with the
hair.
Right?
Sure, the body's thin. I couldn't be more excited about their start.
Yeah, it's fun.
And I am, like we asked last week after Freeman's hot start, is this sustainable? And we were like, well, no, not at this level.
Yeah.
I'll ask you. They're not going to win 6 of 8 games the rest of the year.
Yeah.
But is this sustainable? And when I say that, I mean, the great pitching, scoring enough runs, winning games, first place. Detroit's off to a hot start, too. Do you think this is fool's gold, or do you think this is what we're going to see?
I think it's in between. I definitely don't think it's fool's gold, but I don't think they're not going to average over 6 runs a game. I mean, it's going to go down a little bit. But they're going to get reinforcements. Like we said, Manzardo, hopefully if DeLauder has a good season in AA, hopefully he's here at some point this summer.
Right.
Maybe, I'll hope against hope that they'll spend a little money maybe to add a bat at some point. I don't think you want to just be like, because we'll see about Freeman. I love what he's done so far. We'll see.
Yeah.
I don't like the right field situation
right
now.
He did misplay a ball yesterday.
Yeah, but he's learning a new position.
And that's, by the way, of all of the plays that he's going to be asked to make, in my view, someone else might tell you differently.
Yeah.
I played center field for a long time. The sprint to the fence where you're running glove side and it's everything, the depth of everything is off, and it just takes, there's a learning curve to it. And he was clearly mistimed his jump. He misjudged his spacing to the wall.
Yeah.
But he'll get that. Other than that, he looks like he's been playing center field his whole life.
Right now, it's an exciting time. And the division's looks challenging because the Tigers maybe have arrived here a little bit. We'll see. They got a lot to prove also.
I'm excited for opening day.
Yeah.
Our home opener.
Oh,
I can't
it's gonna
wait
be
for
awesome.
That. Yeah. Okay.
It'll be awesome. We will talk more Guardians off the top of our WKYC show coming up here in half an hour. Make sure you guys tune in. But right now we are thrilled to welcome in Matt Miller, ESPN draft expert, analyst, guru of all things NFL draft to the show. Matt, appreciate you taking some time to hang out with us today.
Yeah, of course. Appreciate you guys having me on. Thank you.
Matt, I don't know why I think you're a Royals fan. Am I making that up, or is that true?
I am. No, you're absolutely right. That's how long we've known each other. You didn't know which bad baseball team I'm a fan of.
So, Matt, how would you have voted in the recently rejected referendum to spend some money for the Royals and the Chiefs to upgrade and build new stadiums?
Yeah, so I don't live in that area, so I wasn't able to vote, but I'm a little bit south of there. I would have voted no.
Interesting.
I'm not a believer in giving the Chiefs money to add premium luxury suites that only the top 1% can afford.
Good for you.
Via tax money. I'm just not, I understand. I've been very fortunate in life to I can afford some things I wasn't able to when I was younger. I don't know why we expect the working class people of that county to pay for rich people to have more suites at a football game. I'm not on board with that.
No, Matt, the only reason I ask is because here in Cleveland, obviously, the Haslams want a new stadium. They're talking dome. They're talking moving it out of Cleveland to Brook Park, 15 minutes away, whatever. But there's a lot of talk that whatever happens, public money's going to be used. And I believe with you, most of the residents that live in Cleveland, the third most impoverished city in the country, can't afford one ticket to a home game.
Yeah.
And you're going to ask them and put the building of a new stadium on their backs to only supplement the income and the pocketbook of a billionaire who I guess was recently named one of the top 5 richest owners in the NFL. Like
it's crazy.
It makes no sense
it's
to me.
It's crazy.
And
I'm with you.
I know Phoenix recently also rejected a proposal, a referendum to build a new stadium for the hockey team. And I hope that that's a trend. Yeah.
Well, if all the cities do it together, we'll be all right.
That's exactly right,
Matt, let's get to some football here because that's your expertise, of course. You did a 7-round mock draft, which is kind of insane to do a 7-round mock draft, but I love that you do it. And we need it because the Browns haven't had a first-round pick in forever.
A while.
And, right? Yeah. It was funny because for years in the 2010s, it seemed like the Browns would have multiple first-round picks every year. Now they've had none for a bunch of years. So the Browns will pick for the first time in the 50s. We're all thinking maybe they'll draft a wide receiver, maybe they'll draft a linebacker, defensive lineman. I don't know. What do you think makes the most sense for the Browns when they pick, assuming they stay there at 54 or whatever it is?
Yeah, I think defense makes the most sense, in my opinion, especially after trading for Jerry Jeudy. You know, and really this offense looks great. You know, it truly does. You've filled a lot of positions. I even think like a low key good signing was getting Dante Foreman to be a second or third running back. That was another area I thought, and maybe some depth at running back. I really like the way that room looks right now. So I do think defense is an area where, you know, we've seen some additions at linebacker, a backup defensive tackle comes in. So I honestly think you can maybe just sit there and say, who's the best defender on the board? In that 7-round mock draft, I had them grabbing Devondre Sweat, the massive nose tackle out of Texas, kind of with the idea of BPA on defense. But also, there's a part of me that just wants to see Myles Garrett get more one-on-ones, because you have this 366-pound Outland Trophy award-winning defensive tackle really messing things up in the middle of that line. And so people who haven't watched Sweat, I would encourage you to like find the YouTube highlights if you can. He is very, very disruptive despite his size. A lot of people are going to see that and say, oh, he's just a nose tackle. He can absolutely collapse the pocket. And we know how much interior pressure is going to help what I think is the best defensive end of football, Myles Garrett, coming off the edge.
Matt, you know, they talk about the quarterback position, and this year is no different. You always seem to be two or three quarterbacks that are, you know, coveted, taking a little bit higher than they should. I've seen mock drafts where there's as high as six quarterbacks going in the first round. Do you think that's a bit much? And what is your prediction on, you know, how many quarterbacks will ultimately be taken in the first round?
Yeah, that's the kind of hard slash fun part of this job, is you evaluate players, you put a grade on them, and then you see how many get overdrafted. And I think for quarterback, it is a trend of guys being overdrafted. You know, we can go back to Mac Jones being selected at number 15 overall. Now, that was way higher than most people had him rated. I had Daniel Jones with a third round grade. The Giants took him in the top 10. So I do think this year, the number I feel comfortable with is four. You know, we're going to Caleb Williams, Jaden Daniels, Drake May, J.J. McCarthy. Five, maybe Bo Nix or Michael Penix Jr. slide in there. I don't think, personally, I don't think we will see six. That is a lot of quarterbacks there. And even this year, we saw how much movement there was on the backup quarterback market, or on the, you know, bridge quarterback market. That did fill a lot of needs for teams, even like the Raiders bringing in Gardner Minshew. And I know Gardner is not, you know, a Hall of Famer, but he's a quality bridge starter. So a team like the Raiders, you would say, yeah, they have a need at quarterback, but they have Aiden O'Connell, they have Gardner Minshew. Do you really throw them into the mix in the first round? Personally, I don't, but we could certainly see five go.
Matt, one of the big debates is who goes first at wide receiver. For most, it was a foregone conclusion all year that it was going to be Marvin Harrison Jr. But there's been a lot of talk, and I don't know how realistic it is, that, you know, he ends up going to the kid from LSU. Who's going to be the biggest impact receiver here? And I'm not saying who's going to go first. You can tell us that. But who do you think is going to have the better NFL career?
Yeah, I would still take Harrison Jr. as the guy who goes first and who has the better NFL career. So much of that question is, you know, based on where they go, the situation. And that's the fun part. You can watch these guys get drafted by a scheme, or, you know, that have a certain quarterback and say, oh, man, I would love to flip my rankings almost, because now that we see the fit, we understand how much better it's going to work out for that player. But I do think Marvin is just almost being over-evaluated at this point. I think there's some paralysis by analysis going on, because we've known for so long how great he was going to be. But, you know, the route running ability, the hands, the speed that he has at his size still makes him a rare prospect. I think oftentimes in this business, we get excited about shiny new toys. Malik Nabers kind of came out of nowhere this year, so there's a lot of excitement about him. But I think, you know, when you're trying to make that decision in 3 weeks of who's coming off the board as the first wide receiver, whether that be the Cardinals, the Chargers, the Giants, somewhere in that 4, 5, 6 range, it would be very hard for me to say no to the pedigree of Marvin Harrison Jr., the production that he had at Ohio State. And something gets lost, guys. He went from C.J. Stroud with Jaxon Smith-Njigba opposite him. Those guys are gone. Everyone in the world knows who's getting the football at Ohio State now. You have an uneven quarterback in Kyle McCord. He only had 10 fewer receptions for like 100 fewer yards and the exact same number of touchdowns, despite everyone knowing where the ball was going game after game after game. So his ability to produce without those legends around him tells me that, like, this dude is absolutely ready to be a number one receiver in the NFL.
Great Matt, point.
You know, usually in the history of the NFL, tight ends take time to develop offensively. Last year, we saw Sam Laporta, probably the best rookie season I can ever remember, at least statistically for a tight end, you know, from a, I guess from a fantasy perspective. Not, I'm not looking at the blocking and stuff like that. And even Dalton Kincaid had a really good year as a rookie, not quite as good as Laporta, but really good. Does that affect where Brock Bowers, like, does he, you think he moves up because teams now will be a little more aggressive at that position?
Yeah, that very much so. I do think that could get him to 10 with the Jets. It could get him to, you know, 15 with the Colts. It's probably his floor. You're right. When I started in this business, tight ends was like a project. You never saw those guys come in and play right away. That has changed. You know, we could even look back at, like, Kyle Pitts had 1,000 yards his rookie year before they forgot how to throw the ball in Atlanta.
Yeah, right.
So there are other guys who, like, they've had a great immediate success. I think what makes Brock unique is, you know, he's not this physical outlier like a Kyle Pitts. You know, he is 6'3", barely, 240 pounds. He's not a, you know, he's not a 4'4 guy. He's just a really, really good football player. More in that Sam Laporta mold. Laporta was, you know, picked in the 30s. So I think that'll be the question of how early do you draft not just a tight end, but a tight end who doesn't have physical outlier attributes. And we haven't seen a workout from Brock Bowers. That's another part of this, because he had the ankle injury this season. We haven't seen him run a 40-yard dash. We haven't seen him do a lot of the athletic testing that you would like to see in order to compare him to some of these guys. But I do think, you know, if we're just talking who are the five best football players in this class, he's probably on that list. So I do think 10 to 15 is where we see him come off the board.
You know, I'm all into Operation Stockpile. You may not have heard of it. It swept the nation. The Cleveland Browns are stockpiling people. They even stockpile quarterbacks and coaches now. I'm looking to get another receiver. Which one of these guys do you think will be available at 54 between Xavier Leggett, Pearsall or from Florida, Troy Franklin or Ladd McConkey? Which one of those guys could potentially be on the board at 54?
I would say of those four, your best bet is for Ricky Pearsall and Troy Franklin. Franklin is really an interesting prospect. You know, he's a skinnier guy who is a vertical stretch player, but he tested pretty poor in terms of acceleration and burst. So I think that's pushing him down a little bit. I actually have like an early round three grade on Franklin. He's a very narrow framed guy, kind of tight hipped, but when he gets loose deep, good luck stopping him. So I think if you find a specific role for him, and the Browns have, you know, some great wide receivers, you could do that. You could put him into a specific role. Ricky Pearsall, I have moved up since the Senior Bowl, since the Combine. I feel like every time I watch him, I move him up a little bit. I think he's right there in that range that you're talking about, middle around two. And he is, man, guy who attacks the ball really, really well in the red zone. He does have that, I think, a little more first step twitch than Troy Franklin does. Maybe doesn't have quite the build-up speed, but really, really great short area quickness and burst.
Matt, let's talk about the current Brown receivers. We know Amari Cooper, we don't need to talk about him. We know how good he is. But obviously the acquisition of Jerry Jeudy, the guy had a ton of potential, first-round pick. He hasn't lived up to that potential. He hasn't been terrible, but he's just been kind of a guy. What are your expectations for him? What did you think of him coming out? And how high is his upside still in year five, his first year with the Browns?
Yeah, I really liked him coming out. I don't have it in front of me, but he was one of my top receivers in a really, really good receiver class that year. I thought he was someone that would be, you know, this fantastic breaking route runner, because that was what he was so good at Alabama. There were focus drops in college that would kind of frustrate you a little bit, but he always bounced back from that, which was encouraging. You know, I think it was the LSU game. He drops one in the end zone, next play scores a touchdown. So you saw kind of that ability to battle some adversity. It just didn't work out in Denver. I think some of that was, you know, he never had a consistent quarterback getting him the ball. He was never, quote unquote, the guy there. I think that's a big adjustment for players coming from college to the NFL, is you go from being the dude at Alabama on a loaded team to being a second or third option in the NFL. That's a little bit tougher, but I love the low-risk investment here, and I think playing opposite someone, Amari Cooper, also a Bama alum, he can kind of, you know, put Jerry under his wing a little bit and show him the ropes of how to be a professional. But, you know, there were times when Jerry would absolutely look like that number one wideout. It was just a little bit inconsistent in Denver, which is why he's available. But I like it here, because he doesn't have to be the focal point of the offense. You have Coop, you have Njoku. Like, there's, you know, Moore is a really good receiver as well. So he could come in and be maybe that secondary option, which I think is best for where he's at in his career right now.
Matt, I know you said you think five quarterbacks go off the board in round one, not six. And Caleb Williams gets all the press, and he's the guy that everybody say is going to be the first off the board. What is your degree of confidence, 0 to 100, that he is going to be the best quarterback long-term that comes out of this draft?
I would say pretty high, 80%, 85%. Wow. And again, so much depends on fit. You know, we could see Drake May go to the Vikings, where you have Justin Jefferson and Jordan Addison and two really good offensive tackles. And that's a great fit for a rookie quarterback. But I think with Caleb, the reason I am so confident is he has the most unique skill set of, man, he's a great thrower, wonderful arm strength, really, really good field vision. He's also a great runner. We saw that 14 rushing touchdowns the last 2 years. He's a great runner. And that to me just is exactly where the NFL is going. And let's not sleep on what the Bears have done building out this offense. They've done a really nice job of adding, you know, number one weapons for him in the pass game, building up the offensive line. They've got two really good tight ends. They've got a deep running back room. So I think Chicago is, you know, we'll see what this looks like because it is very, very much new. But I think this is a better landing spot than it would have been a year ago for a quarterback, certainly. But I'm a big, big believer in Caleb Williams, who, like Marvin Harrison Jr., is 1,000% being over-evaluated. And I think a lot of words have been put in his mouth, you know, that have given people a perception of him that's not accurate with who he actually is as a player or as a person.
Yeah, draft propaganda.
Thanks, Matt.
Crazy.
Yeah, it's the time
Matt,
of year.
I know you got to go. Thanks a lot. We appreciate
it, man.
Yeah, thanks so much, guys.
Great
awesome.
Info.
That
Great
was
info.
Matt Miller of ESPN Draft Expert Analyst. Make sure you guys follow him on Twitter at NFL Draft Scout and much, much more. We got one last topic, but before we get to that, a quick reminder that eBay Motors is now on the Ultimate Cleveland Sports Show rotation. Passion, drive, and patience. That's the formula for winning championships. It's also what keeps your ride or die alive. eBay Motors has everything you need to maintain your vehicle, level it up to peak performance, superchargers, roof racks, exhaust kits, LED headlights, and more. Whether you're into speed, power, or style, eBay Motors has you covered. With over 122 million parts for your number one ride or die, you'll always find exactly what you're looking for. And with eBay's guaranteed fit, your part is guaranteed to fit your ride every time or your money back. Because with eBay Motors, you're burning rubber, not cash. With all the parts you'll need at the prices you want, it's easy to make your car the MVP and bring home some huge wins. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions do apply. eBay guaranteed fit only for U.S. customers. We saw the Browns extend Jerry Jeudy before he stepped on the field. On the opposite end of the spectrum, we saw the Houston Texans de-extend. Shorten?
De-extend's
not a word, but they essentially bought out the final 3 years of Stefon Diggs' contract, gave him his guaranteed money he was owed for those final years up front. He is eligible now to be a unrestricted free agent after the 2024 season. I can't think of another time that's happened. If you guys can, inform me. But
I couldn't. Mm-mm.
What'd you guys think of this contract move the Texans have kind of finagled here to fit Stefon Diggs into the fold?
Well, I think they, you know, like Bull said earlier, they might be in between a position where they're thinking, look, we made a little run last year. We won a playoff game. We got a rookie quarterback on a rookie contract. We want to see if we can catch lightning in a bottle. Maybe we get hot. We have Nico Collins. We've brought in Joe Mixon. Tank Dell is coming back from injury. So now we add one of the best receivers in the league to a very young team on the turf. And they look like they could be a contender. And it works out well because for both sides, if you're Stefon Diggs, you're saying, okay, well, I can go. I'm gambling by taking, you know, an opportunity to go play for a new team and a rookie quarterback or a second-year quarterback. My numbers may go down a little bit, but I'm getting all my guaranteed money up front. Now I get to go back to free agency, get another bite at the apple. And if I have a great year, now I can put myself in position to get a really nice bag and I can hit free agency again and go to and have a choice where I want to go. So it works well and it gives cap flexibility to the Texans. If he turns out to be not a great risk, he doesn't turn out to be what they thought he was. Maybe he isn't explosive. Maybe he lost a step. They get out in 3 years and they, you know, wipe your hands free, go back into the, you know, free agency, go get another quarterback or a receiver and go draft a receiver if they want to.
Yeah, I mean, this is a great move for both sides. I mean, it's irrelevant how much they're paying him because it's only 1 year.
That's exactly right.
The Texans, I think, had the fourth or fifth most cap space before this move. So they had plenty of cap space, and they can do it because their quarterback's on his rookie contract.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly right.
Right?
That's why.
And what they thought is like, okay, he's old. I mean, he's not old. He's 30.
But he's getting to the age as where, at a wide receiver right. where the production starts to fall off.
Right. And at the end of this four-year contract, well, we're going to have to start paying not Deshaun Watson, C.J. Stroud. So, like, let's take that out of the equation. We got tons of cap space now. Let's pay him a boatload of money now. Yep. If he's great, maybe we can work something out next year. If he's not, okay, we wasted money 1 year. Who cares? That's just the owner. That just doesn't affect the team. Yesterday, we did a really fun assignment. We spent a long time on this. We ranked the top 10 teams in the AFC in terms of running back, wide receiver, tight end combined.
Okay.
The Browns finished what, fourth we had them?
We had them fourth, correct.
The Browns fourth. The number one team was the Houston Texans.
Well, Bull,
and that's not even including the quarterback, who I think we all love. He's got to prove it. You got to do it 2 years.
I want to see it a second time, but I think if he does what he did last year, next year, he's a top five quarterback in the AFC.
100%. So, AFC, the NFL.
Perhaps.
Yeah.
Perhaps. So I want to give a shout out to the Houston Texans as right now, I think, being the best run organization in the NFL.
And they, for years, had been the worst.
Without question.
One of the worst.
I mean, to me, when you look at some of the things they've done in the 5 years preceding, you're scratching your head saying, where are they going? What are they trying to accomplish?
Yeah.
I don't know if this is a situation where the owner finally said, I suck. Yeah. I don't know what I thought I did.
Yeah.
I'm going to bring in a guy who does. They have, look at last year, they had the offensive rookie of the year and the defensive rookie of the year.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when has that ever happened?
And if Tank Dell hadn't gotten hurt, he probably would have finished second.
He would have been second. So here's what's curious to me about this move, and I agree with you. I think it's a great move for the Texans.
Yeah.
Because they have their rookie, their quarterback on a rookie contract.
Yeah.
They give them more flexibility. They recognize that, and they went for it. The only question that I have about this is if, and it's a win-win for him because he's getting his money.
Yeah.
But Steph is also planning on putting a big year up and getting the bag.
Yes. Yes, that's
he's got some competition for balls in Houston now.
100%.
Where in Buffalo, when you looked at their offense, you're like, it's going to Steph. He's going to have a big season.
Right.
And he always did. Now I'm wondering if this goes sideways early and Tank Dell emerges as the clear wide receiver one that we think he is.
Well, and last year Nico Collins was their
and
best
Nico
receiver.
Collins. Well, right. I mean, so you've got two guys there that are going to give him a lot of competition for catching footballs.
Right.
Steph Diggs' reputation when the ball isn't coming his way is what?
Yeah, he's a pain in the ass.
He pouts.
Yeah.
He's a baby.
Now, the one thing I'll say is, in Buffalo, you always had to put your best corner on Stefon Diggs.
You did.
That might won't be the case necessarily in Houston.
Pick your poison.
Yeah.
Pick your poison.
And C.J. Stroud has had, I mean, look at the receivers he had throwing to Ohio State. He got Garrett Wilson the ball. Elijah got the ball. Marvin Harrison got the ball.
He had a triumphant of guys there, too.
Jackson Smith and Jigba got the ball. His demeanor, people rave about C.J. Stroud's, like, leadership and just how he is. Just, you know, just.
First of all, off the football
field. Yeah, off the
football. Just a quality young man.
And the one thing I'll say, too, is apparently Stefon Diggs had I was reading yesterday that the Bills had said, hey, you could kind of talk with all these teams. And you said you can't talk to the Chiefs, apparently. That was the only team he couldn't talk to.
Yeah.
And so.
Shout out to them for that.
So, like, he knows what he's getting into. He knows the Texans have all these good players.
Sure.
But I think they're going to be a team that throws the ball a ton because they got a great quarterback.
I think they are, if I'm picking a dark horse right now, it's the Texans. And I don't even know if they qualify as a dark horse because they won a playoff game last year. But I think when you ask 100 NFL experts, what does the AFC look like? You're going to get three teams, and Houston's not going to be in them. So that's why I say
Who are the three?
Kansas City, Cincinnati, and Buffalo.
See, I think Houston replaces Buffalo now as the third team.
Or do they replace Cincinnati? I don't know.
Maybe. I just look at the as much as I think Josh Allen's great, who's around
who's going to catch the football there now?
They got worse skill position players. Like, we were talking about the Chiefs. Oh. Your Chiefs have a better running back than the Bills. They have a better tight end. And Rashee Rice is better than any receiver they have.
James Cook's better than Pacheco.
I don't
agree with that.
Cook was terrific last
year. I know he was. I'd still rather have Pacheco.
But they both have value. I think for the Texans, my overarching thought about what they've done in the last 2 years is eye-poppingly impressive.
100%.
And I think they're going to be in the mix next year to make a deep run in the AFC.
At very least, they will be on TV a boatload of times.
Yeah, they should. They're going to be fun to watch.
When that national schedule comes out, Houston's going to be on it.
Yeah,
no doubt. They're a legitimate contender.
I always think about this, though. Do you think, because Deshaun is very connected still in Houston, right? And they still like him down in Houston. There's a lot of people that still do. Do you think he looks at that, at the Houston Texans team, and says, I got to get my team on that level. I got to get my team on that level.
If he's being honest with himself,
right?
And he were to be asked, if all things were be equal,
yeah,
would you rather be in Houston right now or Cleveland? And forget all of the history with Houston. He would probably look at that Houston roster and say, yeah, I'd like to be there. We know he doesn't like playing in cold weather.
Yeah,
and he's got, you know, the confines of a dome and comfy conditions in Houston. I think their wide receiving core is definitively better than Cleveland's now.
Yeah.
So if he was being fully honest, I think he would say, yeah, give me that situation again.
Does he feel pressure to beat the Texans?
Sure, he better.
Absolutely.
He better.
Yeah.
Like, because they upgraded, and the only difference is, like, you know, when you look at them and you look at the way C.J. Stroud played, and then you look at what they got.
C.J. Stroud has made people in Houston forget about Deshaun Watson.
Right. And I think one of the things that he feels is like, I need to make people remember who I am. I think that
I hope so, because that could be a motivating factor.
Yeah.
He's too young to be riding into the sunset.
Right.
And what's funny, Jay, in the end, and I agree with all you said about the Texans organization, they've done a great job the last few years. But the most important thing that happened to them was luck. The luck that Carolina took Bryce Young.
Oh, you're absolutely right.
If it wasn't for that,
you're absolutely
they wouldn't
right.
be where they are.
No, I completely agree with
actually,
that.
It goes one step further, Bull.
Yeah.
Because Houston converted a crazy fourth down conversion in week 18 against the Colts, which then knocked them back to the second pick. If they had the first pick, they may have taken Bryce Young. So it actually was twofold.
I can't imagine they would have.
And then falling to the second pick, and then Carolina taking Bryce Young.
I think 29 out of 32 teams, maybe 31 out of 32 would have taken.
We should have asked Matt that. That actually would have been a good question.
Yeah. It is the best.
He maybe had the best rookie season we've ever seen from a quarterback.
And
certainly up there.
Well, if you look at the fact that he won a playoff game in his first year, and it's all about the playoffs, then by that metric, he's
and
certainly
statistically,
in that,
he had some of the best stats ever.
It is the best competition I've ever seen in the AFC.
Oh, the
right
AFC is ridiculous.
It's gonna be tough.
It's the best I've seen.
All right, we're taking a 3-minute commercial break. You can rejoin us on WKYC Channel 3 or on the WKYC Plus app if you're outside the Cleveland area. See you in 3 minutes.
The best sports talk in Cleveland is coming to 3. Tune in every Friday at 12:30 p.m. for the ultimate Cleveland sports show. Jay, G. Bush, Bull, and guests tackle the Browns and more. The ultimate Cleveland sports show, now on 3, Fridays at 12:30 p.m.